We will tackle what went down on Saturday at Torrey Pines with Patrick Reed, Shane Bacon with Damon Hack, as we'll take it through everything said and shown from Torrey and Patrick Reed. But we wanted to start here with the actual rule of the embedded ball. This is the definition first. When your ball is at its own pitch mark, made as a result of your previous stroke, and where part of the ball is below the level of the ground, your ball does not necessarily have to touch soil to be embedded. For example, grass and loose impediments may be between your ball and the soil. And then here is the rule, 16.4. If you reasonably believe that your ball lies in a condition where free relief is allowed under the rules, but you cannot decide that without lifting your ball, you may mark the spot and lift the ball to see if relief is allowed. The lifted ball must not be cleaned except when it's on the putting green. That's the rule. We'll go to the 10th hole on Saturday.
At this point, Shane, Patrick Reed has a four-shot lead. Hits the shot from a fairway bunker. It's headed left. See, it bounces. And then Patrick approaches the ball and starts a conversation with a volunteer.
Got a foot behind my flag.
Did it bounce?
No, I didn't see it bounce.
Okay. Hey guys, I'm gonna check it. They said it didn't bounce. Oh, rules official.
Thanks.
Think it broke ground. That's not my decision.
She's gonna put this right here for right now so don't touch it.
Yeah. Hey, bud. They said it didn't bounce, and so I checked it, and I believe it broke ground, but I'm going to let you make that call. Right here.
What are you talking about?
Embedded ball.
Oh, where's your
ball? Like, well, since I picked it up to check, I mean, it seems like it broke ground, but I want you to double check. They said it didn't bounce.
You mind if I stick my finger in there?
That'd be the only way you'd be able to check, isn't it?
Yeah, I feel a lip on it.
So. I thought so, but I just wanted to double check.
Yeah.
So does that tee go... Where does that tee go?
You get one club length from that hole.
From the hole.
Yeah. Used to be closer.
So Patrick Reed makes his par, but the story doesn't end there. It becomes a social media firestorm.
Yeah, I mean, everybody talking about it. Everybody questioning what he did. A lot of decisions will unfold. A whole bunch of that. Before we dive into our thoughts on it, we do want to hear from everybody involved in that situation following the round.
The biggest thing was we were in that fairway bunker off the tee and caught a hair heavy, so the ball kind of went high and left. And we were all watching it, and we didn't see the ball bounce, but the lady was pretty quick on top of the volunteer to put a flag. And, you know, when that happened, first thing was I asked the, you know, playing guys I'm playing with, hey, did y'all see the ball bounce? Everyone said no, and then I asked the volunteer who was right there, who marked it, who was closest to the golf ball, did you see the ball bounce? She goes, no, it did not. And so at that point, I told the guys, hey, I'm going to check to see if it's embedded, which I marked the ball, lifted it, and placed it over the side, and it looked like it did break the plane, and therefore, when it looked like it broke the plane, what I did is I called over the rules official, and the rules official came over, and he put his finger down and said, no, there's a lip here. It definitely broke the plane, therefore, you know, it's embedded ball. You get a club length and, you know, and take a drop. And at that point, we did exactly what we were supposed to do. And, you know, the great thing was when I walked up into scoring and first time actually hearing about it, he calls our group over, has a phone out, and he shows us the video. And we're all watching it, and I'm like, we're all just kind of confused, like, what, you know, what's going on? He goes, I just want to let you know what you've done here, and the whole procedure was textbook. It was perfect. So with doing the procedure correctly and doing exactly what you're supposed to do, at the end of the day, you know, that's what we felt was the right thing, as well as what the rules officials felt were the right thing. And, you know, it happened that the ball did bounce. And when that happens, the rules official said, well, what the whole group, as well as volunteers, since no one saw it bounce, therefore we were able to take relief. Now, if the video or someone was said we saw the ball bounce, then obviously I wouldn't have marked the ball or even attempted to ask for an embedded ball, because as you know, if the ball bounces, I mean, it's literally impossible for the ball to plug at that point.
He did everything he was entitled to do under the rules. He hit a second shot. He was got to about 10 yards. I have video evidence. He had got to about 10 yards of the ball. He asked a volunteer that was standing right there if it bounced. The volunteer said it did not. He then went down. He marked his ball. He was entitled to lift it. And then he called for a referee. He let his fellow competitors know that he was going to lift his ball. None of them saw it bounce. Obviously, he didn't. It's on video that he didn't. So it was reasonable to conclude that was his pitch mark and it was embedded.
Those watching may not understand why he decided to pick the ball up to try to determine if the ball was embedded without a rules official with him. But that's kind of standard operating procedures out here. Is that right?
Yes. The player's entitled to do that. He did call for a referee after the fact, but the player's entitled to do that. He did nothing wrong. He like I said, he marked it, he lifted it, and then he called for a ruling.
Well, Dane, we just flew cross-country, suitcases in the hotel room. Now time to unpack all of this and everything that went down with Patrick Reed. Initial thoughts when you saw what happened last night and you started to digest everything that you were hearing online, seeing online, and seen on video?
Yeah, I watched it about a dozen times or so last night and again this morning. I'm just not comfortable with Patrick's behavior around the ball. You know, I always thought that the golf ball, you treat it like the Hope Diamond. You treat it like a Fabergé egg, especially when it comes to an unclear situation. So right here, we're seeing Patrick kind of hovering over where he says the ball was embedded, and it's just hard to know what he's doing. Like, where is the official at this point? You know, we're supposed to take him at his word, but there just seems to be smoke. I'm comfortable with smoke in the NFL and the NBA and Major League Baseball, where you're supposed to flop. You know, you steal signs. You steal plays. That's why they call things gate, spy gate, deflate gate. I'm expecting that. With golf, I want full clarity. Golf's about clarity. It's about doing everything you can to make sure you are within the rules and doing the right thing. So I just don't know what's going on around the ball. And that's why I'm uncomfortable with what I saw yesterday.
A lot of movement around there. A long time spent as well. And there's so many things we'll touch on here. And the buzzword that we heard throughout the night into today is optics, right? And optics, it's not about right or wrong at times with optics. It's just what people see. There's a moment in this great show, Ted Lasso, on Apple TV, if you hadn't seen it, it's awesome. But there's a moment in that show where Jason Sudeikis' character, Ted Lasso, is out with his star player's girlfriend, and they're having lunch, and paparazzi takes photos of them, and they're going to go sell them to a tabloid. Now, neither person in that scenario did anything wrong, but it looked wrong. To me, this looks bad for Patrick Reed, a guy that has history of doing these things. You know, 99.999% of golfers in this world play golf without rules officials or anybody hovering around to help us out.
Right.
It's about us. It's about honor. If you were playing someone for $25 or $50 and something like this occurred, I guarantee your eyebrows would have raised.
Yeah, I would have hoped that person would call me over to say, hey, you know, what's going on over here? And the fact that the ball did bounce and we have video evidence that that ball did not land in its own pitch mark, that makes me scratch my head even more, because Patrick even referred to that. He says, obviously, you know, if it's not in the same pitch mark, it wouldn't have been embedded. And he asks the volunteer, and she says, no, I didn't see it bounce. But we know that it bounced. So what's going on here? So now we have to lean on the fact that Patrick Reed does have a history. I go back to 2019 in the Bahamas, the par 5 11th hole, where he, you know, has the brushing away of the sand, and then he later says, well, it's my word against their word. And he says that when I get in the sand, he goes, I'm afraid of getting close to the golf ball. That's his direct quote. I'm afraid. Every time I get in the bunker, I'm scared to even get my club close to it. He's close to it, Shane Bacon. He's not just close to it. He's sweeping it away. And when you tell me that high-level players can tell me the difference between two clubs that weigh 0.01 ounces in the difference, he's not feeling that. So we already have this situation. And we have the smoke and mirrors about his time in Georgia, where he was kicked off of the team and had to transfer to Augusta State. So he does have a history, and now we have another situation.
Yeah, and after the round, one of his quotes he said to the media, is he said, quote, you know, when the ball bounces, it's almost impossible for it to break the plane. And so therefore, when that happens, anytime you see the ball bounce, you just play it as it lies. That takes me back to 2013 Masters. You remember when Tiger Woods rattled the flagstick, ball goes back in the water. After the round, Tiger said, I went back to where I played it from, but I went two yards further back, and I tried to take 2 yards off that golf shot. And by saying that, he's in a way telling you that he did in fact break the rules of golf. And to me with this, Patrick Reed, now, I mean, he didn't see the ball bounce. You and I have hit golf shots from 150 yards or 200 yards, and we have no idea where they landed and how they landed. I understand all of that. And I understand that he consulted with the players he was playing with. That's all factual.
Right.
The point being is he hovered around a golf ball for a long time, and it seemed like he grabbed the ball first and then decided to make a decision on the rules.
Are you comfortable with his behavior around Brad Fable, the rules official? Because he seemed to be dictating what was going on. Patrick Reed was in charge, and Fable was reacting. And that's my problem, that Fable wasn't there first to assess the situation. Patrick Reed was driving the ship at that point, and that just seems odd. I feel like the official at that point should have the loudest voice.
Yeah, I mean, DK Metcalf isn't going up to a ref and saying, hey, the guy grabbed me, let me have your flag, and I'll throw it on the ground. I mean, the other thing is, in golf, we have 18 fields, right? I mean, a football field's 100 yards long. What is that, 5 football fields on a par 5? It's hard to have video and eyeballs on everything going on. In this instance, we actually have video. My question being, considering that the PGA Tour now has been open to gambling and people are having a lot of fun doing that with golfers, and there's so much money on the line, and maybe not for Patrick Reed or Brooks Koepka or Rory McIlroy, does that really matter in terms of 11th or 15th place? But you bring up the people he was playing with, Robbie Shelton, Will Gordon, 25 years old, 24 years old. Shelton's 48th career start on the PGA Tour this year. Will Gordon's 23rd career start on the PGA Tour this week. One spot matters a lot.
They're not going to challenge Patrick Reed.
No, and you don't feel
they
don't
have the resume to challenge Patrick Reed. And he says, hey, guys, I'm doing this. They're like, okay, whatever.
And they're in their own world, right?
Absolutely.
I mean, they're trying to play their own ball. But, you know, if it was Brooks Koepka or Rory McIlroy or Tiger Woods in that group, I wonder if it would have felt a little bit different there. But it is very interesting. A lot to unpack still with this story. And Twitter has been wild. I mean, it's been a pretty interesting day on social media. Jim McClain, famed instructor, said there's no chance Patrick Reed did the right thing picking up his ball, then asking for a ruling. No way. A lot of exclamation marks in that tweet there.
Eddie Pepperell, winner on the European Tour. Of course, it can be true that in the case of Patrick Reed, he may have cheated, but that doesn't mean he always cheats. I've played with Patrick. I was astonished at how skillful a golfer he was. This is why it's so sad that there are so many episodes like this with him.
Colton Nost, not taking a side here, but no one saw it bounce, including the volunteer. That's why it was checked. If someone saw it bounce, we wouldn't be having an issue. Very fair point there from Colt. And then Patrick Reed, and you can dive into social and figure out where this all came from. Patrick Reed's official Twitter account going all caps and pointing out a Rory McIlroy issue on the 18th hole where something similar happened. That tweet's still up from Patrick Reed's official social media account.